Your brand new iPhone 17 Pro, it might already be scratched. We dug into the camera plateau finish and found out why people are calling it Scratchgate, and it's more than anodized skin deep. Love it or hate it, that camera plateau is only scratching the surface of the changes we found during our teardown. This phone actually has one of the more fascinating batteries that we've seen. And no, I'm not talking about the hot-wired iPhone 16 action, though that is still there and it's still very fun. There's something way more interesting going on here, and speaking of interesting, maybe you've heard there's a vapor chamber under the battery. We'll turn our evident DSX-2000 microscope on that one too, but first we've got to get this thing open. First up, my trusty ProTek toolkit makes quick work of those familiar Pentalobe screws. This back panel is so tiny, what could even fit back here? To find out, we'll need to apply some heat. Then I secure my anti-clamp and let the Joule suction cups do the prying. As soon as I have a visible gap, I slide in my opening pick and work my way around. Inside, a small bracket secures the wireless charging cable. Once that's disconnected, the rear panel lifts free. Just as I feared, goodbye to the dual entry design that lets us do most repairs by lifting the back glass. The back glass is a ceramic composite which can shatter, so I'm glad that it's easily replaceable, but otherwise there's not much else to see here other than get a glimpse of the metal encased battery. To get at it properly, we need to remove the display, and I don't love that. So back on the heat mat it goes. After several minutes of heating, I lift the display using my heavy duty suction cup. It's connected by just two press connectors to the logic board. Okay, so we're getting closer to that battery. I'll disconnect the battery cable plus two other press connectors. Then I notice something exciting, new screws. You wouldn't believe the buzz in the iFixit office when we first confirmed it. Torx plus screws in an iPhone for the first time. 14 of them. It's a little tedious and boy are they screwed in tight. My mind started to wander halfway through and a careless slip of my driver left a gash in the graphite cooling film. Well, that's what a teardown marathon does to you. With the screws out, I finally lift the plate and, to my surprise, the battery is attached to it. This isn't a midframe, it's a battery tray. In addition to the screwed-in battery tray, we have Apple's electrically debonding adhesive underneath the canned battery itself. This tray probably doesn't increase the part cost much and allows for reusable fasteners. Assuming Apple will sell the battery in this tray, you won't have to fuss with the adhesive at all. But since it's there, you know I can't leave that electrically debonding adhesive intact. Using my iFixit portable power station combined with Vault Clip, I'll attach the positive lead to the bottom tab of the battery and the grounding clip to the single point on the battery tray that isn't anodized. That'll run 12 volts into the adhesive at the bottom of the battery, and after about 70 seconds, the electrochemical reaction will break down the glue. And out comes the battery. By the way, if your sharp eyes noticed fancy orange prying tools earlier, you've just spotted our latest toolkit. We're now partnering with Jerry Rig Everything to launch the iFixit Jerry Rig Everything tool. Kit. Built on our Moray driver set, it includes Zach's favorite pry sticks in his trademark colors and a limited edition Jerry Rig Everything knife. It ships before Christmas, so maybe put it on your wishlist. Pre-order link in the description below. The battery tray hides yet another interesting change and another first for an iPhone, a vapor chamber cooling system. I think I hear everyone saying, "What's that? Android did it first?" Well, yeah, but maybe now Apple can finally stop throttling its fancy silicon. The top of the vapor chamber sits on the A19 Pro chip. It directs heat away from the chip, spreading it down the tray, which in turn diffuses heat into the metal battery casing and the heat-forged aluminium unibody. If you game or edit videos on your phone, that's a huge win. We can see how effective it is under the thermal camera. We tested the 16 Pro Max against the 17 Pro Max and there's clear throttling on the 16 Pro Max. It hits 37.8 Celsius and throttles down. The 17 Pro Max chugs at a continuous 34.8 Celsius. So how does it work? A vapor chamber is basically just a fancy metal pouch with a drop of water in it that is repeatedly boiled, evaporated, and condensed, and it's very, very efficient. It all comes down to convection. Thanks to our partnership with Evident Scientific, we can take a very close look at the interior structure. And I'll be honest, none of us were expecting the inside to be so pretty. The beautiful lattice is functional too. Sandwiched between two plates, it acts as a wick spreading out the water inside the vapor chamber. Held by the lattice against the SoC, the water will boil and turn to steam, then collect on the other, cooler side of the chamber. The large indentations in the copper are a bit like stalactites and collect the water vapor against the surface, allowing the vapor to cool down, condense back into droplets, and spread back out along the lattice. So what's left? Down at the bottom, a mix of tri-point, Phillips, and standoff screws free the Taptic engine attached by a press connector. There's a similar mix of screws on the other side, which frees the speaker module. We don't like designs that force you to change screwdrivers over and over. Tool changes slow down repair and increase repair costs. Screws are better than glue, but boy are there a lot of screws in this thing. Unlike the iPhone Air's 3D printed titanium port, this one is mostly made of plastic and far less modular owing to the number of ancillary connections that rely on this single flex cable. Moving to the top of the phone, the front-facing sensor assembly comes out after unplugging its two press connectors. Then it's on to the three cables that free the rear camera cluster. The very final component to come away is the brains of this outfit, the logic board. We have a few press connectors to deal with on and around the board, but also a sneaky 5G millimeter wave antenna press connector underneath. It's the familiar sandwiched logic board design we're used to seeing. To ID the chips, I'll need my reflow station to split the layers with a special guest appearance by Jerry Rig Everything's knife. I bet you've never seen a board split with one of these before. Seriously though, if repair is your goal, I wouldn't recommend this. Instead, go sign up for the iFixit Pro Repair Academy and microsolder like a pro, not like a YouTuber. Inside the logic board sandwich, we can see the prominent A19 Pro system on chip, as well as the new N1 chip, forming part of this USI package. And while Apple did add their own ultra-wideband chip, the C1X from the iPhone Air is nowhere to be seen. Instead, trusty Qualcomm fills the role of cellular modem. After all this digging around on the phone, did you forget about Scratchgate? We're finally down to the anodized aluminium shell, and Apple promoted the new heat-forged frame as lighter and stronger, but reviewers note it scratches, scuffs, and deforms more easily than expected. The switch from titanium is definitely controversial. Here's the kicker though, it didn't need to be this bad. As Zach Nelson points out in his video, the anodization is weakest on sharp, unchamfered corners, which in the Pro and Pro Max models is the anodized edge on the plateau. The Air and the base model don't suffer from this because those phones have a ceramic glass back cover. We're really able to see what's going on with the scratch test under Evidence Scientific's DSX 2000 microscope. I'll be using a Mohs Level 4 hardness tester, and that's roughly the equivalent of a copper penny. Notice the scratch on the flat orange surface where the anodization has properly formed in an even and thick layer. We still get a visible scratch, which isn't great considering the hardness of keys and pennies in a pocket, but it's not terrible. The scratch doesn't peel away the orange color. Now let's contrast that with the scratch on the plateau where the anodization is mostly supported by another layer of anodization instead of the underlying aluminium. And that's pretty terrible. To understand what's happening here, we phoned a friend. David Niebuhr runs Niebuhr Metallurgical Engineering and is a professor of mechanical engineering at Cal Poly. He says the kind of damage we're seeing here is called spalling, but before we get into that, let's take a look at what anodization actually is. Anodizing is an electrolytic process that grows a protective oxide layer on a metal surface. Basically, the metal surface is corroded carefully and the layer of corrosion protects the underlying metal. The oxide layer is usually grown by submerging the part in an electrolyte bath and passing a current through it. 2 years ago, our M3 MacBook Pro teardown covered this in depth. The controlled corrosion eating away at the surface created the matte space black finish. We're seeing the same bumpy finish on the iPhone 17 Pro, infused with the orange dye. Not all metals can be anodized, but both aluminium and titanium can. In fact, one of our engineers went ahead and anodized the titanium frame iPhone 15 Pro. We have an entire blog post about the process, link in the description below. Apple is probably using an immersion bath, not wiping the frames with kitchen sponge. So is the problem that the phone's made of aluminium and not titanium? David Niebuhr tells us that titanium oxide is a little harder than aluminium oxide, but the difference wouldn't account for the spalling we're seeing. The issue is the shape of the phone, specifically the sharp edge of this camera bump, which the anodizing doesn't adhere to as evenly as across the rest of the phone. The anodized layer is more brittle than the aluminium that it sits on. On flat, even surfaces, that oxide layer deforms together with the aluminium when a scratch occurs. That's why you don't see bare metal underneath. But when there's an edge to the oxide layer, like at the edge of the camera plateau, the brittle oxide bears the stress of your keys or coins rubbing against it, and so it spalls. You can't just fix it by making the anodized layer thicker. That might even make it worse. And despite reports of scratching on the iPhone Air and base model iPhone, we haven't really seen the same level of failure. For one, those phones both have a glass back panel, which, on a level 4 scratch test, is harder than the Mosepick we're using. There's no damage at all. So Scratchgate is real. Unless you put a case on your phone, that camera plateau is probably going to see some damage at some point during the phone's lifetime. The problem does seem to be restricted to the Pro and the Pro Max models for the time being. Repair-wise, the design changes that the 17 Pro brings to the table are also a bit of a mixed bag. We have an amazing screwed-in battery system that is fantastic for repairability, but almost all repairs now have to go through the display, and the USB-C replacement procedure is pretty tedious. On the whole, this phone is only slightly less repairable than the Air, which we tore down over the weekend. We're still getting day one repair manuals directly from Apple, and we expect to see parts on Apple's self-service repair website. Generally speaking, it seems like Apple's designers did actually consider repairability in the construction of this phone, and that earns the iPhone 17 Pro a provisional repairability score of 7 out of 10. Our Apple teardown marathon is far from over, so make sure you're subscribed to our YouTube channel for more gadget guts and the latest repair news.